Hey guys, how's it going? Like Butter here, and I'm officially in the end game in the Division 2. Definitely took me a little bit. I have about 40 hours clocked. So I took my sweet time when it came to playing through the game because I was just enjoying the side missions and going around and collecting things in the open world. I actually enjoyed that so much that I didn't spend much time just skipping or being as efficient as possible to get the 30. And I'm going to talk about how to be as efficient as possible today, since today the game did release for standard edition users. And I feel like a lot of you guys are probably going to feel like you have to play catch up to all the people that had the game 3 days early. I want to let you know that that is not the case at all. You can play this game at your own pace. Don't feel like you need to skip ahead, because what I'm going to explain to you guys is why it's okay to just take your time, right? So a lot of people don't understand how the world tier system works in the end game. So you hit level 30 and then you get into world tier 1, and then you do a couple of activities. You have to go around, you do your invaded missions that unlocks the strongholds, you do the strongholds, you get a certain gear score, and then you get leveled up into the next world tier. That's essentially how it works. I haven't even leveled up to world tier 2 myself, so I'm assuming that's how it works. Maybe if you guys know there's anything different, you guys can let me know, of course. But essentially, you're moving up these world tiers, and eventually you're going to hit world tier 4, which is the max world tier in the game right now. World tier 5, however, we don't know when the release date is. If I had to make a guess, I would say in a couple of weeks. I'd say probably like 2 weeks from today, we'll see the world tier increase. So what that means is that world tier 4 is basically the cap right now. So, you know, people who rush right to level 30 as fast as possible are now min-maxing in world tier 4. Well, the thing is, when world tier 5 gets added, all those people that min-maxed world tier 4 are basically just going to have to switch their loot out anyways. So what this does, and I think this is absolutely genius, is it allows people to find bugs, glitches, exploits, anything like that, and keeps them from basically getting the best gear in the game, because that was a problem in the Division 1. If you guys remember the whole Bullet King fiasco where people were basically getting unlimited, they were getting unlimited materials and stuff, so they could just craft unlimited items, which would give them a huge power spike in the Dark Zone, and it would be really hard if you didn't exploit to be able to compete with those players. So what this allows them to do is kind of see if people find any bugs or exploits to get gear, and then they can patch that stuff, and then they can release world tier 5. Another thing that this does is it allows everyone to have the same amount of time in world tier 5 to level up for the raid. As far as I know, they're probably going to be doing a world's first raid, where everyone's going to compete to see which group gets finished with the raid first. Now, in order to keep this fair, because they did 3-day early access for people who had, you know, gold editions and up, to keep this fair, basically what it's going to do is it's going to allow everyone time to get up to world tier 4, which I'm assuming is going to be about 2 weeks, which is more than enough time to get there. And then we're all going to level up together in world tier 5 and loot up together in world tier 5 to get ready for the raid. That's what I think is going to happen. And then I think the raid is probably going to come 2 weeks later. Now, I could be completely wrong on that. That would be what I think they're going to do. Now, it could come in a week from now. I have no idea. They haven't mentioned anything. But if I had to guess, I'd say 2 weeks, boom, you know, Tidal Basin's going to come out or whatever it is. World tier 5 comes out. And then, you know, world tier 5, everyone, you know, loots up together, and then 2 weeks later we get the raid. That's what I think is gonna happen. I have no idea. We'll have to wait and see. But that's why I want to let you guys know, you know, some of you guys want to be efficient and that's cool, but don't feel like you have to play at the fastest pace possible to catch up. There's no reason to do that. You can take your time playing through the game, enjoy it. The side missions, the story missions, the strongholds are phenomenal. There's tons of open world activities you can do to earn loot and, you know, get commendations and earn cosmetics and stuff and finish and get like blueprints for certain things. Like, there are so many things, guys, so many things in this game that just should not be skipped, in my opinion. But However, for those of you guys who are like, all right, now tell me what I need to do to get through as fast as possible, because that's what I want to do. If you want to get through to level 30 as fast as possible, basically what you do is you blow right through the campaign, do all the main story missions, from start to finish, and save all your side missions last, because the way the side missions work, and this is to keep people from, getting too stuck in a certain level. Basically, each side mission is going to give you 33% progress. Now, what that means is that you need to make sure on your XP bar that you have room for 33% progress when you finish a side mission. Because what happens is, if you get to, like, you know, say you're like 28 and 3/4, or you have like 28 and you just have a little bit of XP left, what's going to happen is it's going to give you 33% of that level. It's not going to give you 33% of that level and then carry over to the remaining percent of level 29. So make sure when you do your side missions, you have 33%, space to get that, that XP, and you don't waste any time. The other thing you can do is you can do projects, and you can donate, like, you know, materials and stuff to projects that will give you XP. But for the most part, the main way to get to 30 is just to skip all the open world stuff, as fun as it is, and just grind right through the main missions and then save the side missions for later. That's pretty much it if you want to get there as quickly as possible. I highly suggest not doing that and going through and doing things at your own pace, and like if you want to go through and get attachments and stuff. The reason is because getting attachments early game isn't really worth, because the negatives are so drastic on the attachments in the early game that you're most likely not going to be using attachments in the early game anyways. Now, the reason that is because the attachments don't scale, which means if you are level 2 or level 3, you're going to get the same negative stats from attachments as you are at level 30. And I actually don't like this. I think that this should scale dependent on your level, so that when people level up, they don't feel like they shouldn't use attachments. But this is why you can just blow through the game without using attachments. And then in the end game, attachments become more important. And you can, you know, now that you have more, you know, stats to play around with, the negatives don't feel as drastic. But I mean, when you're just starting out at low level and you have like 4 crit chance, you know, losing 8 crit chance on putting a mod on is just absolutely detrimental. You know, nobody's gonna do that. So that's what you can do. Go through main missions first, side missions next, and then just get right through. And I think the strongholds are level 26, 28, and 30. And you are going to get loot. We learned this yesterday. You're going to get loot depending on that level, right? So you can't just grind to 30 and then go and do the strongholds and get level 30 drops from those missions. Like, you will get 26 drops from the 26 mission. You'll get 28 drops from the 28 mission. So really, once you hit 26, go do that stronghold, because that's going to give you a chunk of XP. When you hit 28, go do that stronghold, and then it'll help you get to 30 as well. And that, combined with all the side missions, you're going to be able to grind through the 25 to 30 range incredibly fast. You can get through the side missions pretty quick, especially if you're with a group and you're just kind of going around in an area. The Shade Tech, once you unlock your perks, that's another thing I need to mention, is you want to unlock your XP perks first. So in your perk tree in the base of operations, get that before anything else, before, you know, attachments, before extra armor kits or grenades. You don't need any of that stuff. Like, extra armor kits is great, of course, but you want to unlock your XP tree as fast as possible. And once you unlock that, you really don't need to go around and collect the Shade Tech if you don't want to, because like I said, if you're just trying to get to 30 as quickly as possible, you just go through. But I just wanted to let you guys know kind of what the end game is. It's really cool. Like, the Black Tusk moves in. If you don't know who the Black Tusks are, they're basically this faction that's kind of reminds me of the LMB from the Division 1, where they're kind of all they're like SWAT team, and they're all decked out in like the best military gear. It's not like some pleb running around with like a gas mask on, like the Hyenas or something. Like, it's an actual genuine like special force group that moves in and takes over most of the map. And all of those checkpoints and like stuff that you take, those eventually are going to be taken back from Black Tusk, unless you scramble the second you hit 30 and try to get those settlements up and running again. So like basically it just turns your whole map red, and it, you know, once you hit a world tier, it just completely, you know, destroys everything that you've done in the open world. However, that's always good because that's more content. You can go through and do it again, and you can reap the benefits of the rewards. But like I said, the best thing to go out and do open world things for is the loot, and you're always going to be constantly switching loot out up until you get 30 anyway. So in a way, even though you get XP, that can slow down your progress, but I did it that way. And even though I didn't save all my side missions to the end, they give you plenty of side missions. And don't forget, a lot of the side missions will be unlocked once you do your projects. Go to your settlements, do your projects. Those will help you unlock certain things, but a lot of those projects and progression will unlock other side missions in that zone. So what I did is I went through and I did all that stuff, and I took my time and I went slow, and I just wanted to let you guys know you can play through slow as well. Now, like I said, you could play it however you want. If you want to grind right through 30 and you want to start doing Dark Zone PvP and all that stuff, I'm actually personally saving that stuff. I'm doing all the open world PvE stuff first, and then I will start going into the Dark Zone, because I know, you know, once we hit, you know, 70-80 hours, most of my time is going to be in the Dark Zone, and I'm going to be PvPing most of that time. So for me, I have no rush to get into the DZ, because that's going to be essentially all I do, you know. But anyways, I just wanted to make this video, kind of give you guys a heads up about Endgame, what Endgame consists of, and I'm really excited. I'm excited for the raid. I'm excited to get into the Dark Zone and get some manhunts for you. But right now, the open world is so just jam-packed of stuff to do and so rich. I've just been mostly working on finishing my projects and doing all, like, clearing my open world map, even though you can't technically clear it because there's always constant faction battles, which is really, really cool. And I think you guys are going to like that once you get to endgame. But that happens in the early game too. But in the endgame, you know, Black Tusk really isn't messing around. So I even have to go around and start collecting all my world boss cards. If you guys don't know, you get like a deck of 52 cards. Each boss has a different card from the deck, and you have to collect the whole deck. There's just so many things to do in the Division 2. It's just, it's crazy. It's crazy. That's why I just tell people, like, you know, don't worry about getting through as fast as possible, because they put so much time and effort into all these activities. Definitely go through and savor it. I had a friend that made a really good comparison. It's like when you get like a $100 steak, you don't just, you know, eat that as fast as possible and get it down as fast as possible. Nah, you literally let that steak melt in your mouth and you savor it. And that's what I've been doing. So some of you guys have been like, oh my God, you're so slow at leveling up. I've just been going at my own pace. I've been enjoying it. So anyways, guys, thank you so much for watching this video. Hopefully this video gave you an idea of what Endgame consists of and what you can expect. And also, if you want to get to endgame as fast as possible, how to do that, but also to let you guys know about the world tier 5 being held back so that everyone can kind of catch up. So like I said, just go at your own pace, enjoy it. And the Division 2 is a fantastic game, and I know a lot of you guys are enjoying it, which makes me very happy. And I'm happy that you standard edition users get to be a part of the family now and enjoy the game just like we have been. So thank you guys for watching. I will talk to you soon. Be sure to subscribe if you're not subbed, so you, turn that notification on, and let me know what you guys think once you start progressing through the game. Thanks, guys. Take care, and I'll see you soon. Bye.